How should the love of God be? Love for God is a very deep-rooted affection which is a combination of various emotions. This love contains a feeling of submission to one's Creator who is the Lord of infinite might, a strong trust in His infinite mercy, a respect for His infinite wisdom, and a great admiration for His infinite beauty. Knowing that God is the Lord of all adds loyalty and devotion to this love. One who is aware of all these things becomes devoted to his Lord with a very intense love, which is utterly real and pure. In the Quran, God reveals the twisted ideas of love of those who set up other deities besides Him, and says this about the uncontaminated love that believers feel for Him. Some people set up equals to God, loving them as they should love God, but those who believe have greater love for God. If only you could see those who do wrong at the time when they see the punishment, and that truly all strength belongs to God, and that God is severe in punishment. It is God who is truly worthy of being loved, because all those things that make us happy or give us pleasure are blessings from Him. He is the true Lord of beauty. Therefore, the love that a person feels for everything he sees and likes should be turned towards God. Is the love of God not sufficient? Is fear of God also essential? According to the Quran, true love requires respect and avoiding those things of which God does not approve. When we look at the lives and actions of people who believe that love alone is enough, we see that they are not steadfast on the points mentioned above. However, a person who loves God sincerely, follows His commands strictly, avoids the things He prohibits, and is guided towards actions of which He approves. He shows his love by seeking his Lord's approval at every moment of his life by his deep respect for, trust in, and obedience and loyalty to Him. As a result of such concern, he deeply fears losing God's approval and incurring His wrath. Otherwise, expressing one's love only in words, while living a heedless life and transgressing God's limits, is certainly a very insincere attitude. In the Quran, God has ordered man to fear Him. Turn back in repentance to Him and fear Him. Perform regular prayers and do not be of those who ascribe partners to God. What does being pleased with God mean? Being well pleased with God means to be contented with the fate that God has predetermined for one and with what He gives one, unconditionally, and encountering no resistance within oneself. One may not realize the goodness in an event at that very moment, but whether one realizes or not, one knows that God certainly wills goodness in every event. In fact, believers always have infinite trust in their Lord in everything that befalls them. They never wonder whether that event will bring them good or bad, but instead, unceasingly trust in God and know that they will always find good. One may become fatally sick, have a serious accident, and become physically disabled, lose all one's wealth and become poor, be wronged by others, or encounter an utterly different, unexpected event. No matter what happens, one should know that all these things take place under the complete control of God, and therefore feel at peace. That person is completely submitted to God's wisdom and mercy. He gives thanks to his Lord, no matter under what the conditions. This is the behavior that a person who is pleased with God would exhibit. God states the following about his servants who are pleased with him. God has inscribed belief upon such people's hearts and will reinforce them with a spirit from Him and admit them into gardens with rivers flowing under them, remaining in them timelessly, forever. God is pleased with them, and they are pleased with Him. Such people are the party of God. Truly, it is the party of God who are successful. What does it mean to draw close to God? Drawing close to God refers to an enhancement in the love, devotion, and fear that a person has for God. There is no limit to how near one can draw to God. People in the hereafter will be repaid in proportion to their nearness to Him and will accordingly earn an eternal life in paradise. Therefore, the real aim of every man in life should be making a sincere effort as God proclaims. The efforts made by believers in this respect are pointed out in the Quran in these terms. And among the desert Arabs there are some who believe in God and the last day and regard what they give as something which will bring them nearer to God and to the prayers of the messenger. It does indeed bring them near. God will admit them into His mercy. God is ever forgiving, most merciful. The love and devotion that a person who has drawn closer to God has for Him becomes even more intensified. He greatly fears to act in a way which God would not be pleased with and accordingly wards off evil. His devotion to religion, his eagerness and will to serve religion grow stronger. The stronger his closeness to God is, the more all these virtues increase. Is it possible to distinguish those people who are more pious? Which forms of behavior are signs of piety? It first needs to be made clear that the relevant criteria is piety. In other words, fear of God and care over his religion. Outside this, a person's race, ancestry, social status, or material possessions have no importance in the sight of God and Muslims. God expresses this truth in a verse. Mankind, We created you from a male and female and made you into peoples and tribes so that you might come to know each other. The noblest among you in God's sight is that one of you who best performs his duty. God is all-knowing, all-aware. So who are those most possessing piety? It is very definitely impossible to determine who is most possessed of piety in the sight of God. A man's true piety, sincerity, and faith are hidden in his heart, and God is the only one who can know them. People take the measure of that person based on his behavior, the sincerity of a person towards God, his loyalty in religion, the sincere effort he makes in order to earn the good pleasure of God, his eagerness and resoluteness to serve religion, his love for believers, and his loyalty produce an opinion about the piousness of that person. Even so, the final judgment belongs to God alone. Man earns piety by avoiding sins and acts that are forbidden, or behavior that does not comply with the morals of the Quran. Whoever is firmer in living by good morals makes more effort in order to help religion and is more studious in performing the commands of religion. His piety increases compared to that of others. A pious believer reveals himself by his wisdom too. The decisions he makes are right. He finds much easier and quicker solutions to the problems he faces. His speech is much wiser and more impressive. He can perceive aspects of events that cannot be noticed by others, and with a much keener awareness. With the services he performs, he does not aim to emphasize himself, but instead displays a sincere manner. He does not seek the contentment and praise of other people, but the good pleasure of God. Regardless of the situation he is in, he always preserves the limit set by of God. A person who possesses all these features may be expected to be a person of righteousness. But still, it is not possible to form a definite opinion on whether that person is truly a man of piety, or on who has a superior level of faith to whom. That is because man can make only a superficial evaluation based on what he sees from the outside. People's true faith, devotion, sincerity, and nearness to God is known only by God. What does praying with hope and fear mean? God has commanded people to race each other to the good and to perform good deeds in order to earn the contentment of God all throughout their lives. No one, however, is sure of entering paradise as a consequence of what he does. For that reason, no matter how strongly a person is devoted to God and how sincere he is, he lives every instant of his life in hope and fear. Fearing the punishment of hell, he asks for forgiveness for his mistakes. On the other hand, since he sincerely believes in God, he entreats him to forgive his errors. He always has both the fear of entering hell and the hope of entering paradise, until the day of reckoning when the judgment of God will be known. It is related in the Quran that prophets prayed to God in fear and hope. We responded to him and gave him Yahya, restoring for him his wife's fertility. They outdid one another in good actions, calling out to us in yearning and in awe, and humbling themselves to us. What form did the prophets and the believers' prayers mentioned in the Quran take? God has not set any limits to believers on praying, and has invited them to take refuge in Himself and to ask for help in anything they may need, stating, "Call on me and I will answer you." Quran 40:60. When we look at the Prophet's prayers in the Quran, we see that they prayed with a genuine sincerity and turned to God, ridding themselves of everything else. As well as this, the Prophets praised God by His names when praying. That being the case, what all believers should do is turn to God with honesty and true sincerity and reveal all their secrets to Him. Some of the examples that are narrated in the Quran as the prayers of prophets and believers to God are as follows. To guide them on the straight path, the path of those God has blessed, and to separate them from the path of those with anger in them, and of the misguided. To make the place they live as a place of safety. To provide the inhabitants of their city, who have faith in God and the last day, with fruits. To make them Muslims submitted to God and their descendants a Muslim community submitted to God. To show them their rights of worship. To turn unto them in mercy. To grant them good, both in this world and in the hereafter. To safeguard them from the punishment of the fire, not to disgrace them on the day of rising, not to take them to task if they forget or make a mistake. These prayers uttered by the prophets are also a guide for us. We too most frequently pray to God in our daily lives and reveal to Him all our desires and problems. We must not forget that God accedes to the wishes of those of His servants who pray to Him in sincerity. Is repentance at death accepted in the sight of God? God reveals in verses that He will accept repentance from people, but not at the time of death. Even so, man has the chance to repent all his wrongdoings until the end of his life. God has not set any limits on those matters that one may ask forgiveness for. A person might have committed the worst possible crime, or might have been irreligious. Yet regardless of all these things, if he sincerely repents and prays to God for forgiveness and believes in Him, then, as God reveals, he may accept the repentance of that person if he wills it. However, the case of a person who has not found it necessary to repent of a long life of disbelief and to reorient himself, yet expresses his penitence in the fear of death in his dying breath is different. In this case, the decree regarding those who say that they repent is stated in the Quran as follows. There is no repentance for people who persist in doing evil until death comes to them, and who then say, "Now I repent," nor for people who die as a disbeliever. We have prepared for them a painful punishment. People in general pray only at the times of hardships. How is the wrongness of this behavior described in the Quran? People who are remote from the morals of the Quran pray to God only when they face a disease, a trouble, or a disaster. People who seek refuge in God at such times and pray to Him day and night to free them from their troubles and grant them blessings change the minute the situation is resolved. They forget to pray to God and to give thanks to Him for the blessings He has given them. That stems from their not being true believers in the first place. The attitude they adopt in the face of trouble and difficulty comes from the realization of their helplessness. As soon as they are freed from their difficulties, they immediately reveal their insincerity towards God and their true conception of proper morality. The hypocritical and insincere manner of these people is exemplified in the Quran in these words. When the waves hang over them like canopies, they call on God, making their religion sincerely His. But then, when He delivers them safely to the land, some of them are ambivalent. None but a treacherous, thankless man denies our signs. Why cannot one be happy without living by the religion? It is not possible for a person to be happy in the true sense so long as he does not live by the religion. This is because for a person to be happy, first of all, his conscience needs to be at ease. In other words, there should not be anything to cause him distress, confuse him, or to make him feel remorse. Ease of conscience can be attained only in one way, which is to live by the religion. Conscience is under the control of God and always commands a person to believe in God, to fulfill the requirements of religion, and to act in compliance with the morals of the Quran. For that reason, it is not possible for an irreligious person who has been struggling against this command of his conscience all through his life to be happy. God has revealed that man can attain ease of heart and true peace only by having faith in God. Those who believe and whose hearts find peace in the remembrance of God, only in the remembrance of God can the heart find peace. What is the true nature of the life of this world? One of the most serious but largely unacknowledged misconceptions is the supposition that the life of this world is the only real life. In fact, the world is a temporary place created by God to test man. What is real is the life after death. Therefore, everything that charms people and preoccupies them in the fleeting and short-lived existence of this world is an enjoyment of delusion. As stated in Surah 3, verse 14, God warns people against this deception, reminding them that the real, beautiful abode is in the presence of God. To mankind, the objects of worldly appetites are painted in glowing colors. Women and children, and heaped up mounds of gold and silver, and horses with fine markings, and livestock and fertile farmland, all that is merely the enjoyment of the life of this world. Far better is the return to God. As this verse reveals, valuable ornaments, assets, goods, profitable businesses, beautiful and wealthy spouses, healthy children, and fine houses are all values that tie people to this world. One must not forget that all these things are given by God as blessings, and that they are only temporary. As is revealed in a number of verses, the truly beautiful place to arrive at is the home of the hereafter. A person must use the blessings given to him in order to prepare for the hereafter. People who act in the awareness of that important fact are never beguiled by the baubles of this world. What does being pleased and satisfied with the life of this world mean? Being satisfied with the life of this world means making plans only for this world, neglecting the life of the hereafter, and living solely for this world. Such people prefer the life of this world, which lasts only some 60 or 70 years, to the infinite life of the hereafter. They forget that the life in paradise is perfect and endless, whereas this world is full of imperfection. Seeing the life of this world as near and that of the hereafter as distant, they desire to enjoy this world. Yet their biggest mistake at that point is their failure to make any preparations for the hereafter while living the life of this world. However, those who aim at the hereafter will be able to enjoy both the gifts of the life of this world and the beauties of paradise. On the other hand, those who are satisfied with the life of this world will benefit only from the world and will receive their punishment in the hereafter. The reward of those who are pleased with this world is related in the Quran in these words. As for those who do not expect to meet us and are content with the life of this world and at rest in it, and those who are heedless of our signs, their shelter will be the fire because of what they earned. Those who forget their Creator and devote themselves greedily to the life of this world will lose a life full of infinite blessings. Moreover, in the hereafter, they will never be able to attain these things they were so devoted to in this world, not even for a moment. What is the point of not being punished immediately for the mistakes one makes in the world? The fact that he is not punished for his mistakes immediately should by no means encourage a person to slackness. This is because God gives people a specified time, and thus tests them as to how they will behave. He promises the life of paradise to those who do good, and the life of hell to those who do evil. That being the case, someone who is not immediately chastised for the wrong he has done should be under no misapprehension. On the contrary, he should immediately realize that he has been given time to repent out of the love and compassion of God. In the Quran, God informs mankind of this fact in the verse, "If God were to take mankind to task for what they have earned, he would not leave a single creature crawling on it. But he is deferring them until a specified time. Then, when their time comes, God sees his servants." A person of reason must seize every opportunity to repent his errors and put them right, or to make every effort not to repeat them. What are the divine reasons for the weaknesses people have in the life of this world? There are many physical drawbacks afflicting man. First of all, he has to keep his body and his surroundings clean and constantly look after them. The time he spares on this care takes up a large part of his life. However, no matter how much care he takes, or how much cleaning he does, the effect is only temporary. A person who brushes his teeth will find that just 1 hour later, his teeth will feel as if he had never cleaned them. Someone who takes a bath in the summer will feel as if he has never done so at all, just a couple of hours later. What is important to understand here is that such physical drawbacks have a specific purpose. These are not inherent weaknesses, but have been specially created. In the same way, old age and the changes that accompany it are also weaknesses devised by God to make people think about the temporary nature of human life, to avoid becoming attached to this world, which is full of imperfections, and aim at the hereafter, which is the real abode. God has advised in Surah 6, verse 32, that the best objective for man is the hereafter. The life of this world is nothing but a game and a diversion. The hereafter is better for those who are pious. So will you not use your reason?